W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Losing a Kingdom, Gaining the World by Ambrogio A. Caiani, narrated by Mark Elstob. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Mark, chapter 8, verse 36. Note on papal communications. The terms used to describe papal letters, communiques, and pronouncements can be confusing. To make matters worse, the formats, contents, and purposes of these documents were not standardized by the Curia, and popes could be a little inconsistent with the terms they used to describe their public announcements. By the 18th century, most papal communications were printed and circulated widely. In general, throughout 1700 to 1903, popes communicated with the Catholic world with the following types of open letters. Papal allocution, a solemn pronouncement from the papal throne delivered in secret, or in modern times in public consistories, meetings at which a quorum of cardinals are present. It usually concerns some moral or ethical issue. Papal brief, literally from the Latin term breve, meaning brief or short. These letters constituted relatively straightforward papal pronouncements that were inscribed on vellum, then sealed with the fisherman's ring on simple wax. Papal bull, similar to a brief, but more solemn and closer in appearance and content to letters patent issued by monarchs. These solemn acts generally had legal standing, bestowing powers or rulings on complex matters. These bulls were signed by the Pope, monogrammed, countersigned by officials in the Curia, and affixed with the great seal of the papacy, usually made of lead. The etymology of the term comes from the Latin term bolla, alluding to the melting of lead or other metals used to produce the seal for this document. Papal encyclical. Lengthy circular letters by popes reflecting on specific contemporary questions, or offering theological guidance or interpretations on important issues. This practice was introduced by Benedict XIV in 1740 with his encyclical Ubi Primum. Although these letters were part of the Catholic magisterium, they were not necessarily considered to be infallible statements. Papal decree. This was a subspecies of papal bull that decreed or ruled on a specific issue that had been referred to the papacy or its courts. It was a solemn and binding decision from the Pope. Apostolic constitution. Another type of papal bull containing the most solemn and important type of legislation issued by the Pope in his capacity as spiritual leader of the Church. The Constitution's Ineffabilis Deus, 1864, on the Immaculate Conception, Dei Filius et Pastor Aeternus, 1870, on the results of the First Vatican Council, and Munificentissimus Deus, 1950, on the Assumption of the Virgin Mary, are considered infallible papal pronouncements on Catholic teaching. These texts ranked among the most important written acts issued by the papacy and its curia. Introduction. Peking, 1705. On the 31st of December, 1705, wind and snow battered the walls of the Forbidden City. An imperial litter, richly decorated with silks, passed through one of the flanking arches of the Meridian Gate. Its central archway was reserved exclusively for the Emperor. It is likely that a special dispensation had been granted for this mysterious visitor to pass through the Gate of Heavenly Splendor and alight in front of the Hall of Persevered Harmony. Here, the sovereign of the Middle Kingdom undertook his most significant court rituals. This ceremonial route was used by the highest-ranking mandarins and members of the imperial clan. Through the sedan chair's screens, horrified Qing courtiers glimpsed a fearsome and bearded barbarian. It was an unprecedented honor for a non-Han dignitary to enter the Forbidden City with such pomp. For this European prelate, some of the ceremonial of the Chinese court must have seemed familiar. Indeed, to be carried in pomp and deference was hardly shocking to a man who had been educated in the papal court in Rome. On the other side of the globe, until the 1960s, popes were raised high on the sedia gestatoria to elevate them both literally and symbolically above the masses. Some pontiffs who suffered from vertigo closed their eyes and held the armrests of their chair firmly in terror. Others, like Pius IX, experienced seasickness and terrible nausea due to the wave-like movement that was produced by their carriers. On a richly decorated sedan chair borne by the great nobles of Rome, the pontiff could be seen by crowds seeking his blessing on St. Peter's Square and inside the basilica. This foreigner had travelled from the other side of the globe and had grave business to transact with the Son of Heaven. Kang Zi, Emperor of China, had acceded to the Dragon Throne at the tender age of 7 and would reign for over 6 decades. For a remarkable first-person narrative, see Jonathan D. Spence, Emperor of China, Self-Portrait of Kang Zi, New York, 1974, and Dominic Leven, In the Shadow of the Gods, The Emperor in World History, London, 2022, pages 289 to 299. As only the third member of his dynasty to rule, he had developed into a wily, energetic, and ruthless ruler. The Qing Empire was the most populous and economically prosperous power in the world. It controlled the fate and livelihoods of millions in East Asia. Good relations with this superpower remained a top priority not only for its tributary vassals, but also for the European trading empires. Yet this distinguished visitor was neither a merchant nor an emissary of secular power. Charles Thomas Maillard de Tournon was the first official papal legate, ambassador, to Imperial China. He bore the title of Patriarch of Antioch, which according to tradition had been St. Peter's first diocese. As a prelate, he was dressed in flowing purple robes and might well have passed for a mandarin but for his dark beard. If tact is the biggest asset for a diplomat, then a robust gastrointestinal system must come a close second. Tournon had started his journey in February 1703, and it took him almost 2 years to reach his destination. As a native of Piedmont, his diet had been rich in dairy foods and red meat. The French East India Company ships in which he sailed inevitably passed through India. The cuisine on board changed, becoming more spiced, not to mention covered in flavoursome sauces. The papal legate had always suffered from colitis, and Asian food triggered this affliction pitilessly. He spent most of his long journey on ships, canal boats, and litters in a far from dignified position. Eventually, he grew feverish and was largely incapacitated for much of his embassy. His arrival in Peking was an anticlimax, and he would spend almost 3 weeks convalescing, unable to attend to his official duties. His first audience in the Forbidden City was delayed to allow him time to recover. This postponement irked Kang Zi, who was eager to join the traditional winter hunts at Mukden in Manchuria. Yet the enlightened emperor prided himself on his patience and urbanity. Not only did he wait, but he also bestowed on the foreigner the unique privilege of not being obliged to kowtow before him. This custom was mandatory for all persons ushered into the imperial presence. All had to prostrate themselves 3 times and tap their heads on the ground 9 times before the Son of Heaven. Given his gastric turmoil, it was feared that the Patriarch of Antioch might not be able to stand again if forced to perform this ritual. Yet it was highly irregular for this prostration to be waived. Kowtowing in Europe has been portrayed as grovelling and a mark of oriental submissiveness. Such an assessment is deeply unfair, and indeed, the practice was hardly as exotic or alien as such hostile descriptions make it appear. Until the 20th century, Catholics were expected to kneel and kiss the Pope's silk slippers in deference to his position as Christ's vicar. As Paul VI realized only too well, this was hardly dignified in the modern world, and he abolished the practice in the 1960s. As a further concession to his health, Tournon was also permitted to sit in the imperial presence, a privilege usually only reserved for those who had passed advanced examinations. The mandarins were furious that this outsider was given honours usually reserved exclusively for their estate. Tournon's audience with Kangxi came at a crossroads in the history of the church's relations with the Far East. The Italian missionary Matteo Ricci had arrived in China in 1582. He had made an exceptionally good impression by becoming near fluent in Mandarin and well-versed in the works of Confucius. The mnemonic and pedagogical techniques he brought with him were particularly appreciated by Chinese scholars and administrators. His fellow Jesuits, following his example, became well-respected at the imperial court for their Western knowledge. As favored scientists, astronomers, engineers, and artists, they represented an important conduit for exchanges between East and West. Indeed, their skill as cannon designers and ballistics experts was put to good use by the imperial armies. Even the collapse of the Ming dynasty in 1644 did not put an end to Jesuit influence in the Middle Kingdom. Their role as cultural intermediaries was highly prized by the Qing emperors, who filled the power vacuum left by their predecessors. The learning, artistic abilities, and open-mindedness of the Jesuits deeply impressed Kangxi. Giuseppe Castiglione's paintings and images depicting courtly life in Peking offer a unique Western glimpse into early Qing China. Their lifelike qualities and graphic precision were much prized by the imperial court and demonstrated how well the Society of Jesus had integrated among Chinese elites. In the same way as the Jesuits monopolized the positions of confessors and chaplains for the Catholic monarchies of Europe, on the other side of the world, they had the ear of the Son of Heaven. This may explain why, in 1692, Kangxi issued an edict of toleration. He granted Christian churches his protection and declared freedom of worship within his vast domains. Even missionary activity was granted tacit permission to continue, and converts could be made, at least discreetly. Unlike Europe's courts, which were sectarian in nature and persecuted heretics, the Chinese emperor fostered a polyconfessional empire so long as his secular authority was unchallenged. The key requirement of the Edict of Toleration was that all subjects of the Son of Heaven would continue to participate in Confucian state rituals and ancestor worship. This involved the cyclical commemoration of the great philosopher of the 6th century BC, who had provided China with its worldview and ethos. Confucianism has no eschatology, belief in an afterlife in the limited sense of the term, as it is more concerned with ethics and behavior in the present rather than with the hereafter. This has allowed it to be seen more as a secular ethos rather than as a theological cosmology. Confucius's teachings provided a guide to a virtuous life and harmonious society, in much the same way as Plato and Aristotle's writing had done in Athens in the 4th century BC. At different moments of the year, the Chinese educated classes burned incense and provided sacrifices of food to their ancestors, who were commemorated in inscribed clay tablets. The Jesuits, with their intellectual agility, had interpreted these practices as secular rather than religious. Did not Europeans honor and evoke their dead in a similar manner with elaborate grave sites? Equally, did not Catholics venerate the memory of the saints, whilst at the same time maintaining their monotheism? Given that much of Confucianism seemed secular, they assured the emperor that Chinese rites did not conflict with Catholic teaching. But their progressive and tolerant interpretation of Confucian culture was to prove controversial in Europe. Back in the Vatican, the Curia, or church administration, was none too sure that these Chinese rites were compatible with Catholic teaching. The Chinese ancestor tablets seemed to imply that they were a receptacle that contained the soul of the ancestor being commemorated. Was this not idolatry, rather than mere respect for the dead? Furthermore, there were several Chinese words for God, and at least one of them could be conflated with worship of the emperor. Any deification of the ruler of the Middle Kingdom was difficult for Rome to swallow. During the mid-17th century, the papacy had sided with the Jesuits' accommodation of Confucianism because it was understood that some acceptance of local customs was necessary to ease evangelization. A failure to do so had contributed in no small measure to the expulsion of all foreigners and the martyrdom of missionaries and Catholic converts in Japan at the end of the 16th century. The goodwill of the emperor was vital if Europeans were to have any hope of surviving in China. Other missionary orders in the Far East, such as the Franciscans, Dominicans, and Augustinians, accused the Jesuits of having gone native. They were probably jealous of Jesuit success and growth in Peking in comparison to their own meager results. These rivals to the Society of Jesus appealed to the Curia, demanding that Rome intervene vigorously on the question of Chinese rights. They urged the Pope to rein in the Jesuits and censure their missionary activities in Peking. Tournon was the first papal legate sent to an Asian emperor, and his objective was to negotiate with Kangxi and to explore if a religious entente between Peking and Rome might be possible. It was hoped that the Son of Heaven would give permission for the appointment of a superior general who would prohibit the Jesuits' harmonization of Confucian ritual with Catholic theology. There was also an unrealistic hope that the emperor might be converted to the truth of the Catholic faith. Tournon's mission was driven by anti-Jesuit animus, and he wanted to clip the wings of this powerful missionary order. Tournon's embassy to the Forbidden City was blighted by ill health, and he never acclimatized to China. His erratic behavior, irritability, and lack of courtesy were probably exacerbated by his infirmities. Very much grounded in the aristocratic traditions of Europe, and particularly his native Turin, Tournon refused to take anyone into his confidence except the emperor. He alienated the Jesuits deliberately by refusing their counsel and by complaining angrily that the house they provided for him was unworthy of his rank. Equally, the mandarins sent to prepare the groundwork for his audience were insulted by the legate's refusal to reveal the purpose of his mission. The hasty and imperfect translation of his letters of credence from the Pope gave the impression that his sole aim was to establish good relations between the Holy Father and the Son of Heaven. Kangxi dismissed this purpose as trivial and was surprised a man might travel 9,000 miles just to seek friendship. The meeting on the 31st of December 1705 between the feverish legate and the emperor was cordial. Indeed, the curiosities, particularly Venetian glass, enameled objects, and musical instruments sent as gifts by the Holy See, stimulated Kangxi's cosmopolitanism and curiosity about the distant West. Eventually, discussions drifted onto the appointment of a superior general in China to oversee the missions. The emperor saw no difficulty in granting this, but insisted that the person chosen be fluent in Mandarin, proficient in the Chinese alphabet and aware of the cultural realities within his empire. In effect, only the court Jesuits would be eligible for this office. These conditions took the legate by surprise and in a direction he had hoped to avoid. Kangxi reassured Tournon that he was informed by the Jesuits that Catholicism and Confucianism were perfectly compatible. The legate regretted that this was not the case. Irritated, Kangxi inquired about specific problems and incompatibilities. Tournon admitted that his knowledge of Confucius's writings was imperfect, but that Charles Maigrot de Crisy, apostolic vicar to Fujian, who was an anti-Jesuit French prelate, would be able to answer such queries exhaustively. The emperor grudgingly accepted this, and Maigrot was summoned to the capital for a conference. In the meantime, by way of diplomatic reciprocity, fine gifts were collected and dispatched on the long journey to Rome. They were precious tokens that would demonstrate that the Pope's overtures were welcome, while at the same time showcasing China's finest silks, porcelains, and vases. During this long interval, the legate was invited to witness the fireworks display for the Chinese New Year in February. But as the weeks turned into months, The Patriarch grew increasingly paranoid towards the Jesuits, whom he suspected of turning the imperial court against him. Tournon suspected that he was the victim of a monstrous cabal that had been organized to doom his diplomatic mission. In March, matters were exacerbated when over 100 Chinese Christians came to petition Tournon at his residence. They begged him to tolerate Chinese rites and not condemn ancestor worship. Frustrated and unwell, the legate tried to tear up the petitions, but was too weak to do so. Not to be deterred, he trampled the scrolls underfoot in a gesture of contempt for the petitioners. Appalled by the legate's behaviour, and to get him out of the capital, the mandarins advised Tournon to travel to the hot springs of Tangshan. They hoped the mineral and curative properties of these waters would restore the diplomat's health and make him more amenable to compromise. During his time away taking the waters, Tournon became violently ill, and he suspected the Jesuits of poisoning him. Despite such tensions, the official dispatch he transmitted to the courier painted his audience with Kang Tsi in positive colours, giving the impression that it had been a great success. The legate knew that his correspondence was intercepted by the imperial authorities. He avoided using a cipher so as not to give rise to offence or suspicion. In Rome, these words were read prematurely as a triumph. Clement XI was so pleased with this news that Tournon was promoted to cardinal. After a slow journey along China's complex network of canals, Bishop Maigro arrived in Peking. He carried a list of 48 Confucian principles incompatible with Catholicism. An audience with Kang Tsi was scheduled forthwith. To the emperor's amazement, it soon became apparent that the apostolic vicar's Mandarin was poor and that he needed an interpreter to be understood. His arguments failed to persuade Kang Tsi, who found Maigro's knowledge of Chinese philosophy deficient. When asked to translate and interpret the inscriptions above the dragon throne, Maigro failed to do so. Far from being qualified, this prelate was clearly ignorant of Chinese characters and incompetent to assess Confucian teachings and rituals. Feeling that he had already conceded too much through his policy of toleration and was receiving nothing in return, Kang Tsi's patience became exhausted. The distinct impression he now had was that the papacy wished to interfere in the governance and religion of Qing China. In retaliation, the emperor refused to sanction papal control over the Jesuit missions. Tournon was ordered to leave the empire immediately. Not only that, but the gifts making their way to Rome were recalled and would never reach their destination. The Edict of Toleration was revoked, and Christianity was viewed with growing suspicion. Despite this, the Jesuits continued to be treated as esteemed courtiers. Four of them were sent to Rome to try to persuade the Pope to change his mind. Most died en route, never to return to Peking. Tournon's last days were unhappy. He issued a formal condemnation of the Chinese rites from Nanking. The imperial authorities hastened his departure towards the Portuguese enclave of Macau. Here, querulous as ever, he fell out violently with the Europeans who governed this outpost. After a few months, he excommunicated the city's authorities over their lack of support for his anti-Confucian stance. In retaliation, the local bishop excommunicated the legate. His premature death in 1710, at the age of 42, finally put an end to this diplomatic debacle. Rome came to realize that the mission to Peking had been a dismal failure. 10 years later, Rome sent another legate, Carlo Ambrogio Mezzababba, across the world to meet with the now aging Kang Tsi. This mission granted ad hoc permissions for the Confucian rites to be practiced discreetly, yet Mezzababba failed to persuade the emperor to accept the Pope's authority over the small Chinese church within his domains. In many ways, Mezzababba was playing with one arm tied behind his back, for Pope Clement XI in 1715 had condemned the Chinese rites in his decree Exiladie. Kangzi stated categorically that so long as this prohibition remained in force, Catholicism could not be practiced openly in his empire. A final impasse had been reached, and the hopes of persuading China to accept papal authority had proved evanescent. Growing anti-Jesuit sentiment in Europe pushed Benedict XIV, 3 decades later in 1742, to confirm Clement XI's condemnation of Confucianism in the bull Ex Quo Singulari. Thus was halted the progress of Catholic evangelization in China. Only in 1939 did Pius XII finally reverse these myopic decisions with the instruction Plane Compertum. The failure to establish relations between the Pope and the Chinese Emperor was indicative of the Catholic Church's growing unease with the secular state's claim to absolute sovereignty. The unexpected Vatican-China agreement of the 22nd of September 2018 has done much to diffuse long-standing tensions between the Vatican and Beijing. This book examines how, during the Age of Revolutions, 1700 to 1903, Catholicism came close to the abyss on several occasions. Eric Hobsbawm prominently defined this period, 1750 to 1850, as the Age of Revolution. Emperors, kings, dictators, and revolutionaries demanded that the successor of St. Peter bend to their will. The popes of this period steadfastly refused to relinquish their political authority and fought hard to retain power over their small Italian kingdom. They refused to accept defeat even after 1870, when the walls of Rome were finally breached. For most of its history, the Catholic Church has considered itself equal in dignity with the state. In Europe, a close working relationship existed between the Pope and the continent's Catholic sovereigns. Church and state in the early modern world were bound up in an interdependent alliance of throne and altar. Monarchs and their bureaucracies enforced Catholic teaching, along with its dogmas and moral precepts, over those they ruled. To live in the kingdoms of France, Spain, Portugal, and Naples was to be Catholic. To renounce the faith was to become a heretic and an outlaw, punishable by civil death. Early modern states were unashamedly confessional. Such arrangements were replicated in Protestant and Muslim polities, although they tended to allow their subjects a greater degree of reluctant toleration. Catholic princes, in return for their imposition of the one true faith, in most of southern and western Europe, received legitimation from the papacy. The rewards for keeping the papacy on their side were tantalizing. For example, France's ruler held the title of Most Christian King. His Spanish counterpart was proclaimed His Most Catholic Majesty. And across the border in Portugal, the monarch received the accolade of The Most Faithful King. The Habsburgs were Holy Roman Emperors, and as kings of Hungary were styled as Sacred and Apostolic Majesties. Politics and religion cross-fertilized each other before 1700. These pages tell the story of how this once comfortable working relationship between church and state disintegrated during the 18th and 19th centuries. In some ways, the Emperor of China's belief in religious pluralism and his demand that the church be subordinated to the state were signs of things to come in the very heartlands of Catholicism. This process was influenced by several factors, such as the scientific revolution of the 17th century, whose mantle was picked up by the Enlightenment of the 18th. These movements questioned religion's monopoly on the interpretation of the natural world and morality. Having said this, it's worth remembering that the intellectuals who shared this thirst for objective knowledge were not intrinsically anti-Catholic. Many hoped, as Thomas Aquinas had in the 13th century, that religion could only be strengthened through the application of human reason to its precepts. Yet the arguments of the Enlightenment did provide the preconditions through which many came to challenge the authoritarian nature of church governance. Legal, political, and humanitarian reform were portrayed as areas which should be freed from the shackles of revealed religion. Tradition had held an iron grip on governments and their administrations for centuries. By 1789, few still believed they inhabited the best of all possible worlds, as the unforgettable but hapless Dr. Pangloss prematurely concluded in Voltaire's novella Candide, 1769. Fossilized tradition was lambasted as a barrier to progress and human improvement. This movement would culminate in violent revolution in France during the 1790s. The Catholic Church became the great victim of this revolutionary conflagration. This is hardly surprising, given that the alliance of throne and altar was the antithesis of what these revolutionaries wanted to achieve. Today, the term theocracy has exotic, if not toxic, connotations. A mere Google search of the term will churn up images of the Taliban and ISIS. During the 18th century, theocracy remained very much alive in Europe's ecclesiastical principalities. There seems to be no synthetic study of the concept of theocracy in early modern or 18th century Europe. Not only was the Pope the head of the universal church and the great custodian of Catholicism's magisterium, but he was also a secular prince. He ruled over the lion's share of central Italy, not to mention several small enclaves in Naples and France. Although his was the largest ecclesiastical principality in Europe, it was by no means unique. The archbishop electors of Mainz, Trier, and Cologne not only ruled over sizable and disparate German territories, but they were entitled to vote for the Holy Roman Emperor. Germany, Spain, and Poland were littered with prince bishops who served as secular heads of government. In some cases, prince abbots, like those of St. Gallen in Switzerland and elsewhere in Germany, were rulers of microstates. Although such power was largely wielded by men, it was not exclusively a male prerogative. Throughout Europe, abbesses were some of the most powerful women in the world. They collected rents, acted as community leaders, and were appointed judges in manorial courts. Political power in Europe had a decidedly theocratic flavour. There was growing scepticism, however, over whether priests could be good rulers and honest politicians. Educated men felt a sense of frustration that in early modern states, entry into the priesthood often constituted a fast track towards power, influence, and wealth. Priesthood was viewed as a career rather than a vocation by many. The Roman Curia epitomized this tendency and was the source of much frustration. It notoriously played a long game and could be painfully slow in coming to decisions, let alone implementing reform. These lawyer priests were the bureaucrats of the Middle Ages. To the bright young philosophers of the Enlightenment, such plodding and quibbling was deeply frustrating. Eventually, the church came under a barrage of criticism. Not all of it came from lay outsiders who detested the privileges of the first estate, the clergy. Sometimes priests and bishops were frustrated by the immobility of their hierarchies and disapproved of their own institutions. Such prelates and clergymen had grown sympathetic to modern theories of social and economic improvement. They engaged with the Enlightenment process and reform by publishing their own visions for a better ecclesiastical future. It was their hope that by internalizing such progressive ideals, Catholicism could not only survive present challenges, but prosper and renew itself. These were minority voices who actively and aggressively tried to reshape their parishes and dioceses in the Age of Enlightenment. The truth remained that the Church of Rome had a decided image problem throughout the 18th century. The First Estate was the richest and greatest landowner in the continent after the monarchies of Europe. Bishops and abbots could easily be caricatured as self-indulgent parasites who provided little benefit to the souls they were supposed to save. Monasteries, which had been suppressed in England by Henry VIII during the 16th century, were a prime target for reformers who painted monks as wasteful, corrupt, and sexually licentious. Calls for the church to be less worldly and powerful multiplied. These reformers, for the most part, were not atheists, let alone modern secularists. They believed in the social utility of religion. For them, the priority was a more pastorally engaged and charitable ecclesiastical establishment. A cost-benefit analysis of the church is not easy, even in the present day, and almost impossible when it is applied to the past. The Catholic Church provided the only proto-social welfare and health care in a society that afforded hardly any state-sponsored assistance to its most vulnerable members. At the opposite end of the spectrum, some bishops and abbots behaved as if the church were an exclusive club that rewarded them bountifully with political and economic privileges. Given such complexity, it is difficult to arrive at an unambiguous assessment of the church's social role during the Ancien Régime. Catholicism protected the weak and poor while simultaneously preying on them. Such ambivalence was at the heart of the Church's vulnerability to criticism. The French Revolution and the Napoleonic Empire opened a Pandora's box in seeking to curb ecclesiastical power. Revolutionaries from the 1790s onwards took it as an article of faith that the Church had to be subordinated to the state. They put pressure on the Pope and Catholics to yield to the ultimate authority of secular government. Rome's refusal to accept lay tutelage unleashed a culture war that persists to the present day. In the period covered by this book, two popes were kidnapped by the French, and a third was forced to flee Rome under cannon fire. For the papacy, bitter resistance was the only solution to these direct challenges. The laity had no right to define morality, nor could it interfere in questions of public worship. Temporal power was the chief battleground in church-state relations during the 18th and 19th centuries. The preservation of the papal states in central Italy became the great lost cause of the Catholic Church. Defending the Papa Re, the Pope-King, was the sine qua non for the papacy's survival. The Pope's status as an independent secular prince, it was argued, guaranteed the independence and freedom of the Church. It was feared that if Rome were conquered and the Pope expelled from the Eternal City, he would be forced to seek refuge with one of Europe's Catholic princes. If the Pope became the subject of a monarch, could this prince not influence the papacy to his advantage? This fear of being subordinated to secular power assumed pathological dimensions as temporal power became imperiled. The maintenance of theocratic government for the papacy and the Church was non-negotiable. Catholics were expected to fight and lobby for the independence of the papal states. Once the Congress of Vienna in 1815 had redrawn the map of Europe, the Pope survived as the last theocrat in Europe. Princely archbishops and abbots of the Holy Roman Empire were divested of their sovereignty. Faced with the mounting forces of revolution, liberalism, socialism, and eventually secularism, the papacy realized that it was living in a hostile environment. Napoleon's annexation of Rome in 1809 to 1814 had shown that laymen could govern even the Eternal City. Indeed, the populations of the legations of Romagna had admired the efficient and well-ordered government forced on them by Napoleon. When papal rule was reimposed, they revolted against the Papa Re with almost cyclical regularity. The collapse of the papal states may not have been preordained, but geography certainly did not help the papal cause. Situated right in the middle of the peninsula, the Pope was surrounded by salivating neighbours, not averse to increasing their domains at his expense. The papal monarchy increasingly found itself a pawn in a delicate diplomatic game between France and Austria. The late arrival of Sardinia-Piedmont onto the scene ultimately proved fatal. Although the papacy would flirt with nascent Italian nationalism during the 1840s, it came to realize that the forces of national identity and cultural patriotism could backfire. In 1848, Pius IX transformed himself from the darling of liberal nationalists to the nemesis of all progress. The Pope did not become the figurehead of a federation of Italian states. Instead, He was surrounded by a modern, unitary, secular state under the aegis of the Savoyard dynasty. When Rome in 1870 was invaded by the troops of the new kingdom of Italy, the papacy refused to concede defeat. The Pope entered self-imposed confinement in the Vatican, a district of Rome which covers less than a fifth of a square mile. For 59 years, the Catholic Church refused to acknowledge the existence of the Italian state. It could be argued that until the pontificate of Paul VI during the 1960s, which abolished the papal secular court, the Pope continued to behave as if nothing had changed. The papacy, dispossessed of its statehood, would spend many fruitless years condemning and anathemizing modernism. If anything was new and progressive, the Pope was unlikely to approve of it. From the depths of the Vatican, popes precipitated a crisis of conscience for modern citizens. To whom did they owe ultimate allegiance, Christ's vicar or the nation? This process was not merely clerical in nature. Pious Catholics across the globe resisted with vehemence attempts to confine their faith to the domestic and private sphere. They were convinced that the papacy should be independent and that the magisterium of the Church should continue to have a role in lawmaking and public morality. As will be apparent, this book is not so much a history of religion, let alone an ecclesiastical history, but a contribution to the politics of religion. The Protestant Reformation of the 16th century had been a theological quarrel about salvation with significant political repercussions. There is an imperfect parallel between Luther's attack on the Church and events during the Age of Revolutions. The revolutionaries had little interest in theology, let alone salvation. They wanted to establish heaven on earth. The control of politics was at the heart of the struggle that pitted the Catholic Church against the modern state. Such stakes were of the highest order, and ultimate power the tantalizing reward. For Catholics, these two centuries were a chronicle of gradual and inexorable political decline and defeat. Having said this, the narrative that unfolds in these pages is not a simple tale of Catholic retreat before a secular advance. It should be remembered that the late 19th century state was itself riven by factionalism and growing socialist agitation. Catholics diffidently came to play the game by forming political parties and trade unions of their own. The biggest paradox is that as the Pope lost temporal ground, his spiritual powers became absolute. After 1870, several European countries aspired to a complete separation between church and state. Secular government lost interest in micromanaging the episcopacy and public worship. In the past, monarchs and the nobility had prevented the Pope from controlling national church hierarchies and defining church teaching unilaterally. Papal authority throughout the early modern period had been diluted by the alliance of throne and altar. The breakdown of this relationship emancipated the papacy spiritually. The culmination of this process was embodied in the First Vatican Council of 1870, which formally declared the Pope infallible when speaking on matters of dogma. While the loss of the papal states was disastrous, it also represented an opportunity which the papacy seized with alacrity. The process was painful as the loss of state protection significantly damaged the Church's economic prosperity. Modern states, which sanction religious pluralism, have tended to confiscate ecclesiastical property and abolish tithes. This ensured that the First Estate no longer had the resources to mount a credible challenge to the authority of the state. Yet the price paid for cutting the umbilical cord that connected the Church to the state was significant. Liberal governments could no longer justify interference when it came to religious questions. If freedom of conscience was absolute, then there was nothing to stop Catholics from opposing divorce and other matters that conflicted with the magisterium. Liberals may have deplored Catholic values, but could hardly silence Catholics' right to free speech. The Age of Revolutions challenged the Church, but undeniably released it from any allegiance to the state. The waning of monarchical and noble influence gave the papacy unprecedented freedom over the nomination of the episcopacy and clerical hierarchy. After 1903, the crowned heads of Europe finally lost their prerogative to veto papal conclaves, elections. The 19th century reacted against the traumatic experience of revolution and Napoleonic conquest. It witnessed an impressive revival of Catholic fervor and devotion at a grassroots level. For the privileged Ancien Régime clergy, engaging with its flock and ministering to souls had not always been a priority. Indeed, aristocratic bishops found it mildly distasteful. After 1815, the Church rediscovered a mass market for saints, relics, miracles, and the re-enchantment of the world. The number of clerical vocations increased exponentially after experiencing a nosedive during the 1790s. It was a remarkable coincidence that this revival of Catholicism more or less coincided with the second wave of European imperialism during the second half of the 19th century. Thousands of young priests, seminarians, and missionaries literally marched before the troops that conquered colonies in Africa and the Far East. Catholicism had already been a global religion in the 18th century, but by the close of the 19th century, its coverage reached almost every corner of the globe. It consolidated its pre-existing positions in South America and the Philippines by negotiating concordats with the post-imperial republics that emerged after the Latin American revolutions. Catholicism's eager collusion with Europe's civilizing mission certainly brought about unprecedented expansion. The Church's complicity in the dark side and human cost of empire is hard to gauge with precision. To portray Catholicism's relationship with empire as purely evil is unhistorical. On the one hand, its pastoral and humanitarian ethos meant that many missionaries were genuinely committed to improving the material conditions of the people they encountered outside Europe. Regrettably, their evangelizing priorities, with perhaps the exception of the Jesuits who had a proto-anthropological vocation, meant that missionary clergy generally did not believe that the animistic religions and cultures they were supplanting should be preserved, let alone understood. Missionary work often brought medicine, food, and education at the cost of compromising indigenous cultures. They simply did not understand or turned a blind eye to the fact their missionary activities made them complicit in an imperial project that was far from benign. It should be clear that the Catholic Church's position during the Age of Revolutions is not an unambiguous tale of decline and fall, nor one of renewal and regeneration. Both these tendencies emerged in the Church of Rome from 1700 to 1903. This book tells the paradoxical story of how the popes lost a kingdom but gained hundreds of millions of souls across both hemispheres. Catholicism burst forth from its European and Latin American heartlands to cover the planet. It was a traumatic experience for the Church, which still haunts it today. Chapter 1. The Alliance of Throne and Altar, 1700 to 1773. The Lion of St. Mark fluttered in the breeze above Corfu while its defenders sheltered behind the mighty ramparts of the Scarpone redoubt. They were a motley group of Venetian soldiers, German mercenaries, and Greek irregulars. Most fearsome were the Schiavoni, whose colourful tunics and furs gave them the appearance more of a band of desperados than soldiers. Although their name is often translated as slave in English, this is a misapprehension. By the early 18th century, they were Christian Slavs who came from the northeastern coast of the Adriatic. Most were Dalmatian subjects of the most serene Republic of Venice. They had opposed Muslim rule steadfastly for generations and fought in many European armies. Their dream was to expel the Ottoman Empire from the Balkans. In 1716, Venetian galleys had failed to repel the fleet of the Capitan Pasha, Grand Admiral, which had penetrated the Corfu Channel. The long-standing Venetian colony of Corfu now faced invasion. On the 8th of July, flat-bottomed barges disembarked a large army on the island. According to contemporary sources, which are unreliable, it numbered around 30,000. Yet the most redoubtable unit were the elite imperial janissaries, who were about 4,000 strong. Over the next few weeks, supplies and a powerful siege train were unloaded. The defensive walls and forts around Corfu were formidable. Despite this, it was clear that the forces of the Serenissima were severely outnumbered. Field Marshal Johann Matthias von der Schulenburg, who had fought alongside Marlborough and Prince Eugene against the armies of Louis XIV, commanded the defenders. These totaled at most 4,000, and their numbers had to be supplemented by the arming of residents of the city. By the 3rd of August, Corfu had been enveloped by the besieging army, which, after several assaults, had succeeded in taking the suburbs. Now the engineers of the Sultan dug trenches, but proved unable to mine the walls of the city. Mortars rained down bombs on the terrified civilian population. On the 19th of August, 1716, the defenders of the great rampart of the Scarponne realized something was afoot. Venice had invested heavily in improving the defences of Corfu. Indeed, the outer walls of the city were reinforced and designed to be impervious to artillery fire. Yet the odds stacked against Schulenburg and his men were overwhelming. As the morning dawned, great clouds of dust and smoke were observed in the distance. This was followed by an intense artillery barrage. Emerging from the dust cloud could be glimpsed the ornate caftans of the janissaries. Their impressive akbuks, or semi-conical hats, were observed getting into line. Then a blood-curdling cry was heard, and the enormous host of the Sultan's finest troops launched themselves forward in a murderous frontal assault on the Scarponne. Kanem Hoka, the Capudan Pasha, commanding the Sultan's troops, had promised 25 reales per Venetian head taken in the offensive. The defenders rained down lethal volleys and used grapeshot to mow down the besiegers, but severely outnumbered, Venice's troops fell back from the ramparts towards the inner walls of the city. Schulenburg realized that a truly dangerous situation had arisen. If the Ottoman troops managed to hold the outer walls, then most of the city, excluding the citadel, was doomed to fall. In the meantime, the Ottomans had raised their crescent banners over the Scarponne in triumph. Their celebration of victory was premature, however. The Venetians had a surprise in store. Unbeknownst to the janissaries, the Scarponne had been mined, and the fuse was lit. Soon, hundreds of Ottomans were killed in a deafening explosion. This not only led to many casualties, but deeply compromised the besiegers' morale. Schulenburg decided to take advantage of the element of surprise. He drew his sword and led 1,000 of his men in a desperate counterattack. Hundreds of Venetian soldiers fell in this strike, but they were determined to retake the Scarponne, which was theirs again by nightfall. Thus, Schulenburg had commanded one of the few successful sorties and counterattacks in the history of early modern siege warfare. The Ottomans limped back to their camp and hid behind their trenches. Yet the situation for the Venetians remained grave. The defenders suspected that the fall of Corfu had not been prevented, but merely postponed. The next day, menacing storm clouds gathered over the island. By noon, the heavens opened and unleashed a terrible torrential downpour. Soon it was followed by violent lightning strikes. This storm lasted for hours and was so bad that the Ottoman trenches flooded and soon turned into streams. Indeed, the besiegers had to abandon their earthworks and take shelter. One stray lightning bolt ignited some munitions, exacerbating the collapse in their morale. For the next few days, Venetian scouts spied a flurry of activity in the Capudan Pasha's camp. They feared that yet another assault was imminent. Then, on the 22nd of August, the Ottomans disappeared, having embarked during the night and departed Corfu. Initially, Schulenburg, concerned that an ambush was being prepared, sent some Greek raiders on scouting expeditions. They found several stragglers abandoned by the Sultan's forces in their haste to leave. These men confirmed that the decision to withdraw had been taken and that the siege had been lifted. The reason for this move has never been satisfactorily explained. Perhaps Kanum Hoka feared that a Habsburg army would soon invade Albania and that he needed to relocate his army to the Greek mainland. Or was it that he had received reports that Spain, Naples, the Knights of Malta and the Papacy had assembled a naval task force that would soon reach Corfu? Regardless of the reason for their flight, the Ottomans abandoned their provisions, their munitions and their siege train. The deliverance of Corfu was seen as a miracle and celebrated as a military triumph by the Serenissima. It was to be their last. Antonio Vivaldi composed the oratorio Judith Triumphans to celebrate this victory. The Old Testament heroine Judith represented Venice's bravery, whereas the monster Holofernes symbolized Ottoman aggression. It ended with a rousing chorus, Salve Invicta Juditha Formosa, Hail Unvanquished and Proud Judith. Schulenburg was feted as the Republic's saviour, receiving a generous pension and the title of Count of the Holy Roman Empire from Charles VI. On his death, a statue of him was erected in Corfu, where it still stands in the old fortress. Halting an Ottoman advance into the Adriatic was hailed as a providential sign of Catholicism's ability to prevail over apparently invincible foes. But as ever, the reality was far more nuanced. Schulenburg was a condottiero and a sword for hire, thus hardly the idealized hero of Catholic lore. He was a Protestant, for starters, not to mention that large numbers of his followers were Greek Orthodox, with a sprinkling of Albanian Muslim irregulars thrown into the mix. Although Venice, in its war, retained Corfu, it lost most of the Peloponnese, which it had conquered only a few decades previously. This was not quite the unambiguous triumph presented in Vivaldi's oratorio. Despite this sobering reality, there had been reasons for celebration for the papacy as the world entered the 18th century. Rome had weathered the storm of the 16th century Reformation well and had checked the Ottoman advance in the Balkans. Yet this consolidation of power was to prove superficial and brittle when placed under strain. The revolutionary conflagration that would erupt in France in 1789 was not a bolt of lightning from a clear blue sky, but the culmination of a process that had been underway for the better part of 100 years. Seemingly loyal Catholic polities had been remorselessly and slowly gnawing at the power of the First Estate. Monarchical governments throughout the continent increasingly viewed the privileges and immunities of the clergy with irritation, seeing them as a roadblock to administrative efficiency. In 1759, Naples Prime Minister Bernardo Tanucci wrote of the clergy that they are the cancer of humanity, presently occupied in avarice, laziness, and they make a nonsense of government. It almost seems as if they entered states to destroy them and oppose their fundamental laws. A year later, his opinion had not improved, and he wrote that all priests and monks were the excrement of humanity, vicious and generally ignorant, with little knowledge of theology or any works of intelligence. This statesman, despite his energetic prose, was no radical atheist, nor an enemy of religion, but somebody who loathed the church's interference in politics and its opposition to rational reforms. During the Enlightenment, there was a growing belief that priests should be priests and stay out of politics. Yet, ancien regime popes were not just spiritual leaders, but secular princes. During the 18th century, their duties as rulers of the papal states occupied much of their working hours. They had little time to be bishops to the diocese of Rome and minister to the faithful. Even within the papal states, it was incredibly rare for ordinary folk ever to glimpse, let alone meet, the Holy Father. Only the citizens of Rome might hope to see the Pope carried high above them on his sedia gestatoria, or as a tiny red-white dot giving the solemn urbi et orbi to the city and the world, blessing from the loggias of Rome's many basilicas at Christmas and Easter. While in theory the spiritual leadership of the church was supposed to consume the Pope's every waking hour, in reality the secular responsibility of governing central Italy competed for the Pope-King's limited time and resources. Separating the Vicar of Christ from the Italian prince was almost impossible. For early modern popes, these roles were fused and went to the very core of their office. The papacy's central Italian concerns left the church open to constant accusations of a conflict of interest. Many wondered if, when the Pope made policy decisions, they were designed to help the church, or whether he was looking out for the benefit of his own principality. In the world of diplomacy, the Holy See held a senior position of honour in European international relations, something that technically persists to the present day. During the Middle Ages, popes had acted as arbiters in international disputes. Rome's nuncios, ambassadors, automatically became the highest-ranking diplomats in Catholic capitals. Given this position of international prestige and responsibility, papal diplomats and cardinal secretaries of state, foreign ministers, had to tread carefully when it came to decisions affecting war and peace. This burden was not something that the church found easy to resolve. Rome found it difficult to play the honest broker in disputes among Catholic sovereigns. For example, Pope Clement XI had been particularly uncertain how to proceed during the War of the Spanish Succession, which was fought between 1701 and 1714. He initially supported Philip V, the Bourbon claimant to the Madrid throne and its vast South American empire. Midway through the conflict, Clement transferred his recognition to the Habsburg pretender, Archduke Charles, before changing his mind again and returning to Philip V. Such diplomatic flip-flopping did little to reassure the chancelleries of Europe that the papacy had clear diplomatic policies. Decades later, during the 1740s, Benedict XIV found it equally difficult to decide what to do during the War of the Austrian Succession, 1740 to 1748. Unlike Clement, he eventually made the wise choice of keeping the Holy See neutral in European conflicts. Although neutrality today is a legitimate position and one that is guaranteed by international law, that was not the case during the early modern period. From the perspective of 18th century international relations, neutrality was viewed by princes as cowardly and dishonourable. It was often the case that belligerents refused to respect the immunity of those sitting on the sidelines. Geography was especially unhelpful to the papal state's desire to remain unaligned. Situated squarely in the centre of the peninsula, the papacy found itself in the unhappy position of forming a buffer zone between the Habsburgs in northern Italy and the Bourbons in Naples. The Pope's domains were often devastated by armies on their way to conquer either Milan or Naples. This made the Pope's neutrality an impossibility, and the economy of the papal states was much exposed to military predation. The relationship between Rome and the non-Catholic world remained fraught. The year 1697 had witnessed a notable success with the conversion of the Elector of Saxony, Augustus II, known as the Strong, from Lutheranism to Catholicism. During the 16th century, the electors of Saxony had been patrons of Martin Luther and champions of the Reformation. Indeed, they emerged after the Thirty Years' War as directors of the Corpus Evangelicorum, leaders of the Protestant princes of the Holy Roman Empire. Their return to the Catholic fold in the 18th century was a propaganda triumph. Yet the dividends of this conversion turned out to be meagre for the papacy. The subjects of the Saxon elector remained staunchly Lutheran and refused to follow their sovereign's lead. Augustus's conversion had been a matter of politics rather than of conscience. To put forward his candidature for election to the throne of Poland, he needed Catholic support. To paraphrase Henry IV, it was clear that Warsaw, like Paris, was worth a mass. The conversion of the Wettins of Saxony to Rome was not an isolated case, and 30 other German princes followed their example between 1648 and 1769. Some princes, like Elector Karl Philipp of the Palatinate, took their family's Catholicism too seriously. In 1719, Karl Philipp tried with some measure of success to make his Calvinist subjects' lives a nightmare. Their catechism was banned, and he demolished the partition wall that separated Catholics and Protestants in the Church of the Holy Spirit in Heidelberg. This struck at the very heart of an agreement which had ensured that both Christian confessions could continue to use this church after the 30 Years' War had ground to a stalemate. In response, the Protestant electors of Brandenburg and Hanover started closing Roman churches within their domains. Indeed, Frederick William II of Prussia gleefully sent grenadiers to dissolve the Catholic monastery of Hammersleben near Saxe-Anhalt. The stage seemed set for renewed sectarian conflict in Germany. Sensibly, Charles VI, as Holy Roman Emperor, demanded Karl Philipp reverse his provocative policies in Heidelberg. This confessional crisis of the 1720s highlighted just how fragile some of the religious compromises created by the Peace of Westphalia of 1648 remained. Some, though outwardly bizarre, were highly practical. For example, although Lübeck's bishop had converted to Protestantism during the Reformation, six of his cathedral canons were still guaranteed to be Catholics. Another anomaly from our modern perspective was the Diocese of Osnabrück. Here, the office of Prince Bishop alternated cyclically between Catholic and Protestant incumbents throughout the Ancien Régime. This was because the population of this princely diocese was evenly divided between those loyal to Rome and those who looked to the Protestant House of Hanover for leadership. When Catholic incumbents died, Osnabrück tended to devolve to the younger scions of the Guelphic dynasty. Indeed, the last Prince Bishop of Osnabrück was George III's son Frederick, the grand old Duke of York, the ineffectual leader of the 10,000 men in the nursery rhyme. Beyond the continent, the papacy's relationship with the British archipelago was difficult. After 1713, Louis XIV had abandoned his support for the Catholic Stuarts claim to the British throne. The old pretender, the uncrowned James III, left France and headed into exile in the Papal States, where he was recognized as King of Great Britain. He was to spend the rest of his life in dreary exile, shifting between the ducal palace of Urbino and the fine Palazzo Mutti in the Eternal City. For decades, the Curia held on to the forlorn hope that an uprising might be successful in restoring a Catholic monarch to the English throne. These hopes seemed to come to fruition with the accession of the German Hanoverians to the British crown in 1714. This dynastic switch precipitated a Jacobite rebellion within a year. After the death of Louis XIV, this insurrection was suppressed easily as the court of Versailles refused to support the cause of the Catholic pretender with munitions and coin. Despite this reverse, loyalists in the Scottish Highlands kept the torch of the Stuart claim burning bright. 30 years later, 1745 saw a spate of Highland rebellions supported by the papacy and supplied with weapons and cash by the French. This final attempt by James III and his son, Charles, to regain their lost throne definitively spelled an end to all dreams that Henry VIII's Reformation might ever be undone in Britain. Protestantism was by then deep-rooted and was not going to be overturned. No amount of scheming on the part of papal diplomatic agents was going to persuade the Protestants of Northern Europe to abandon their religious convictions and accept Rome's spiritual authority. As already intimated, the advance of Islam had been checked. In 1683, the Polish king Jan Sobieski had pushed back a large Ottoman army laying siege to Vienna. Never again would a Muslim power penetrate so deep into the heartlands of Christianity. Indeed, the 18th century saw the Sultan's empire in retreat from the Balkans. Papal galleys and ships from the Knights of Malta joined the Venetian navy to patrol the Adriatic after the Ottoman Empire failed to take Corfu in 1716. Prince Eugène of Savoy's brilliant campaign of 1716 to 1718 against the Turks achieved the Habsburg reconquest of Hungary. The Habsburg monarchy, with the Treaty of Passarowitz in 1718, regained all of Hungary and conquered much of northern Serbia. Catholicism's drift southwards into the Balkans, although welcomed in Rome, brought with it logistical and monetary difficulties. The rebuilding of the Catholic Church in Hungary was a delicate process, in which the clergy were given significant representation in the government of the kingdom, and funds were put aside for the re-evangelization of the patrimony of St. Stephen. It was a reconstruction in which the Church collaborated eagerly with the Habsburg state. The Treaty of Passarowitz, signed on the 21st of July 1718, saw the Austrian annexation of large portions of Bosnia and Serbia to their empire. These mainly Muslim and Orthodox lands resisted conversion to Rome. In the decades to come, it became clear that the Ottoman Empire was far from a spent force. It had received severe wounds, but was far from vanquished, and in fact sought revenge for the humiliations it had suffered in the early 18th century. The Grand Viziers of the Sublime Porte did not have to wait long. Indeed, the Austro-Turkish War of 1737 to 1739 brought a significant resurgence of Ottoman military fortunes. As a consequence of this disastrous conflict, the Habsburgs were forced to return the city of Belgrade and most of Serbia and Bosnia to Muslim rule. Islam may have been beating a slow retreat from the Balkans, but the situation elsewhere saw little change. Throughout this time, on the shores of the Mediterranean, the Barbary pirates continued raiding the coasts of southern Europe and capturing prisoners who were sold in the slave markets of Algiers and Tunis. It must be said that since the mid-17th century, Mediterranean slave raids had been gradually declining. The Knights of St. John did their best from their island base of Malta to counteract Muslim corsairs with their own acts of piracy and North African raids. Yet both their resources and their galleys proved unequal to the task. It was left to religious orders in Istanbul and other Islamic cities to ransom prisoners and buy back slaves as best they could from these corsairs. To thwart Mediterranean piracy, the Pope repeatedly faced calls for funding and military support. In 1737, Philip V of Spain levied taxes on the South American clergy, with papal approval, to help him in his campaign against the Berbers around Ceuta. These military incursions and skirmishes into North Africa changed little, and the population there remained committed to Islam. Even those monarchies loyal to Rome were to experience significant conflict between church and state. The submission of these Catholic dynasties to the supremacy of the Holy See became increasingly grudging. Since the late 17th century, the competition that pitted European states and empires against each other had accelerated and grown more costly. The size of armies and the bureaucracies needed to maintain them had expanded exponentially. The privileges of the First Estate were no mere irritant, but threatened to compromise the ability of Catholic states to compete with the more fiscally streamlined and centralized Protestant monarchies, like those of Great Britain and Prussia. Statesmen in Lisbon, Madrid, Paris, Naples, and Vienna expressed frustration with clerical immunity from prosecution, administrative prerogatives, canon law, and tax exemption. In theory, all questions relating to the clergy and canon law could be appealed to Rome. These ecclesiastical freedoms blunted the efficacy of administrative, judicial, tax, and social reforms. The cohesion of states was undermined by the existence of a First Estate, whose members had few qualms about opposing change. The Council of Trent, 1545 to 1563, had grandiloquently asserted the Pope's primacy over the Church. Yet Rome's supremacy was accepted by neither the crowned heads of Europe nor the regional episcopates beyond the Alps. The Parlement of France, the appellate courts of the kingdom, had refused to register and approve the canons of Trent. The Spanish monarchy, in a similar fashion, had quibbled over details of papal control, and the prince bishops of the Holy Roman Empire in Germany jealously guarded their autonomy from Rome. Indeed, many bishops considered the Pope to be first among equals and resented any interference from the Curia within their own dioceses. Not only was the first estate seen as a roadblock to reform, within the monarchies of Europe, many bishops resented the Pope's jurisdiction over their dioceses. This was especially the case when it came to those monastic, mendicant, and Jesuit orders who were directly answerable to Rome. The regular clergy's independence from diocesan authorities infuriated bishops. By sidestepping episcopal authority, the Jesuits in particular made powerful enemies throughout their existence. This was to have disastrous consequences for them as the papacy and monarchies of Europe wrestled for ultimate control of the Church. For all the confident triumphalism of papal rhetoric and the apparent magnificence of Rome, the papacy's room for political manoeuvre was in practice very limited. Simply put, the Curia could not afford to alienate the Catholic princes of Europe, for a series of complex reasons, mainly to do with venality such as the sale of public offices. The 18th century witnessed a downturn in papal finances. Given that popes had huge spending commitments, not just in central Italy but around the globe, they could not afford to lose support and revenue in Europe. Every acrimonious dispute with a prince could severely damage the church's authority and threaten its financial security. The prime example of such a crisis erupted during the 1680s between Louis XIV of France and Pope Innocent XI. The Sun King had extended his royal rights unilaterally over a small number of vacant dioceses. He claimed the prerogative to administer and distribute the revenues of vacant dioceses pending the appointment of a new incumbent. This led to protests from the Curia and a denial that Louis possessed any such right. Eventually, Innocent XI had refused to confirm the crown's candidates to fill these vacant dioceses. So incensed was the king by Rome's refusal to invest new bishops that in 1682, an assembly of the Gallican French Church was summoned. Here, four articles were proclaimed that ultimately asserted the French Church's independence from Rome. This assertion of autonomy was known as Gallicanism, and was by no means a purely French phenomenon. The bishops of France, in their assembly, had reiterated that church councils superseded papal authority, and that the King of France could not be excommunicated by Rome. It was re-emphasized that only royal assent and a national council of bishops could give papal decrees force of law in the kingdom. In 1693, after a decade of mutual recriminations, a new pope, Innocent XII, found a compromise which allowed all parties to climb down. In return for having his episcopal candidates confirmed by Rome, Louis XIV and his bishops agreed to mothball the four Gallican articles. These articles would experience a remarkable afterlife during the Napoleonic Empire. To an extent, this decade-long standoff proved to be a storm in a teacup. After all, in 1685, the French crown had revoked the Edict of Nantes, which had granted limited toleration to Protestants. This gave rise to a vicious campaign of persecution that resulted in a mass exodus of French Huguenot refugees to Britain, Holland, and further afield. Despite his dispute with the papacy, Louis XIV showed himself committed to imposing Catholicism on his unwilling subjects. The Regalian crisis of the 1680s highlighted the fact that the so-called alliance of throne and altar was not quite an equal partnership. The Gallicanism of the 1682 declaration revivified and awakened the medieval notion of conciliarism. The roots of this concept lay in the 14th century, when for complex reasons, a great schism had emerged in the West. The Council of Constance, 1414 to 1418, had established the principle that an ecumenical council of all bishops superseded the authority of the Pope. During the sessions of this council, two popes were deposed, and a third was elected to take over the reins of the Church, thus putting an end to the schism. Ever since this time, The papacy had tried to downplay the events at Constance, and indeed the theory of conciliarism was deemed to be tainted by heresy. One of the key arguments running through this book is that during the 18th century, a neo-conciliarist movement within European Catholicism challenged the authority of the Pope and the centralizing tendencies of the Curia. Its vision of a more locally accountable church with limited interference from Rome appealed to monarchs across the continent. Princes tacitly encouraged such Gallican and conciliarist tendencies among their local episcopates. Neo-conciliarism put sustained pressure on the symbiotic relationship which characterized the Ancien Régime alliance of throne and altar. The Church legitimated royal rule and the privileges of nobility in return for protection, economic benefits, immunity from secular law, and a monopoly on public worship. One solution which allowed the Church to continue to benefit from this arrangement was to make concessions. This was achieved through a series of concordats and agreements that bestowed on the crowned heads of Europe the right of nomination for vacant dioceses, prestigious benefices, and monastic houses. The best example of this was the concordat concluded between Ferdinand VI of Spain and Pope Benedict XIV in 1753. Rome received a massive indemnity of 1.5 million scudi in return for eye-watering concessions. Henceforth, the King of Spain would have the right of appointment over almost all bishops within Iberia and its empire. Furthermore, papal dues, levies, and annuities within the territories of the Spanish monarchy were abolished, sharply reducing the income of the Holy See. This agreement was by no means unique, and similar arrangements were concluded with Naples, Sardinia, Portugal, Venice, and the Habsburgs. European monarchs used church patronage to reward and maintain the loyalty of their own elites. Reading the surnames of Ancien Régime bishops in France and under the Habsburg monarchy is a bit like perusing a who's who of the European aristocracy. By 1789, the entire French episcopate was staffed by bishops of noble pedigree. The situation in Germany was similar, but the reigning Catholic dynasties were losing their grip on the ecclesiastical electorates and prince-bishoprics of the Reichskirche. By the twilight of the 18th century in much of Europe, the first and second estates had fused together to such an extent as to become indistinguishable. Only Spain and Portugal continued to have an episcopate that was permeable to candidates of common birth. Prelates still had the ability to wield not just influence and prestige, but real power. The 17th century was renowned as the age of the great cardinal prime ministers, such as Richelieu and Mazarin. Their careers were romanticized when they became the villains of the novels of Alexandre Dumas, but clergymen continued to be appointed to ministerial office well beyond 1700. No fewer than three cardinals, Guillaume Dubois, André Hercule de Fleury, and Étienne Charles de Loménie de Brienne, served as principal ministers of the French monarchy. The truffle-munching, culinarily dexterous and militarily astute Cardinal Giulio Alberoni guided the Spanish monarchy's policies for the better part of the 1710s. In 1721, accusations of sodomy put an end to his career. Cardinal József Batthyány, Prince Primate of Hungary and Archbishop of Esztergom, was the chief advisor of Maria Theresa on Magyar affairs. His influence at court and Habsburg politics extended far beyond his family's Hungarian heartlands. Across the continent, prelates served as ministers and provincial governors and presided over estates. Within the church, political influence was not just a matter of ministerial office. Some of the shadiest figures in these realms were the royal confessors. Within the dark confines of the confessional, the monarchs of Europe unburdened their consciences, seeking forgiveness from their public and private transgressions. With a sexual athlete like Louis XV, who established his own private brothel in the grounds of Versailles, one imagines that confession must have been an almost full-time occupation. As the Jesuits monopolized the position of royal confessors, They were suspected of unduly influencing royal policies. Such suspicions were not without foundation, as these clergymen often sat on royal councils and advised the monarch on appointments to important offices. Throughout Europe, reigning dynasties tried to outdo each other in competitive displays of piety and religious fervor. Monarchs needed a dedicated clerical establishment at court to demonstrate their devotion to God. Their royal chaplains and almoners beyond their pastoral office also played significant political roles. The Habsburgs, with their victories against Protestantism and Islam, felt especially beholden to divine providence for their survival and prosperity. The Holy Roman Emperors were one of the most pious dynasties in Europe, creating an endless routine of prayers, masses, worship of relics, and processions. Their court was so priest-ridden and so centered around liturgical celebrations that its atmosphere was labeled Pietas Austriaca, Austrian piety. Such conspicuous religiosity was meant to underpin the Habsburg claim that they were the preeminent dynasty on the continent. In France, the Bourbons had no wish to be outdone in this race towards piety. They claimed to have been endowed with miraculous powers by God. Their coronation ceremony saw them anointed with holy oil from the ampule of St. Remigius. This chrism had the magical property that although it was depleted with each crowning, it would miraculously replenish itself on the eve of each forthcoming coronation. Skeptical philosophes suspected with some justification that the abbot of Saint-Remy in Reims surreptitiously topped up the holy ampule entrusted to his stewardship on the eve of royal investitures. According to legend, this sacred ampule had been brought down from heaven by a dove and used to anoint the barbarian King Clovis as the first Christian king of France. Ever since then, the King of France, like the British monarchs until the reign of Queen Anne, had claimed to have the miraculous power to heal a glandular affliction called scrofula, or the king's evil. There was one major drawback to this, in that monarchs needed to be in a state of grace, that is, absolved of all sin, in order to perform this royal miracle. Given Louis XV's notorious sexual activities outside of marriage, it was often the case during his reign that touching for the king's evil was postponed. This caused a public scandal and drew negative public commentary. The growing influence of science and medicine increasingly made the practice seem pointless at best and superstitious at worst. By the 1690s, when William of Orange became King of England, he refused to utter the formula, "The king touches you, but God cures you," when healing the scrofulous. Allegedly, on the only occasion William performed this ritual, he declared, "God give you better health and more sense." The last time a French king touched for the king's evil was at Charles X's coronation in Reims in 1825, though few were convinced of its efficacy after decades of revolution. But in its heyday, the ritual had displayed the extent to which the crown leant heavily on religion to reinforce its authority and sanction its divine right to rule. As must be clear, the price paid by the crown for this ecclesiastical legitimation was high, and as the 18th century progressed, bureaucrats came to question whether it was worth paying. Not only was the church exempt from all taxation, but it also was entitled to levy tithes on the revenues of the peasantry. In many cases, bishops and monasteries were feudal lords and vast landowners. They held the right to dispense justice on their lands as secular lords of the manor. Church courts like the Officialité, Consistorium, Officialat, and Inquisitions imposed canon law on Catholic populations. Everywhere in Europe, there was next to no separation between God's law and man's law. Cases like that of the Chevalier de la Barre, whose punishment for blasphemy in 1766 was to have his tongue ripped out of his mouth before he was decapitated, his lifeless corpse being then publicly burnt, certainly made many question why a beneficent God demanded such brutal retribution. 6 days after the Chevalier's death, the eloquent philosopher and polemicist François-Marie Arouet, better known as Voltaire, took up the cause. He denounced in print the horrific execution of de la Barre at Abbeville and called for civilization to reject such barbarism. He sent his pamphlet to the great Milanese penal reformer, the Marchese Cesare Beccaria, who had advocated for the abolition of capital punishment and judicial torture. Sadly, this plea for humanity did precious little for the unfortunate and very dead Chevalier de la Barre. Freedom of conscience was to develop slowly in this period, and Catholicism always advocated against any toleration of heresy, paganism, and worst of all, atheism. This goal was greatly aided by pre-publication censorship, over which the Church wielded much influence. The Index of Prohibited Books had the force of law in Portugal, Spain, and Rome. In Paris, the theologians of the Sorbonne advised the Parlement on which books to condemn and publicly burn. It was expected that every pious Catholic would avoid evil books that went against Church teaching. Thanks to the illicit book trade, which was adept at smuggling across borders, the index issued by the Inquisition was often seen as a list of interesting and exciting items that should be read, exactly the opposite to its intended purpose. Benedict XIV, who was a notable scholar in his own right, found the business of banning books painful. He was slow to condemn the path-breaking spirit of the laws by his friend and correspondent, the jurist Charles-Louis de Secondat, Baron de Montesquieu. Even when it came to that monument of sceptical learning, Diderot and D'Alembert's Encyclopédie, he was hesitant. He admired its ambition to record and catalogue the sum of human knowledge. However, its secular and at times anti-clerical entries made tacit toleration of the work an impossibility. But it was also under Benedict XIV's reign that a great miscarriage of justice was corrected. Galileo Galilei's works were removed from the index, but without a fanfare. It would take until the 20th century for a formal rehabilitation of the Pisan astronomer and his vindication of the Copernican celestial system to come from the Vatican. Despite Benedict's gentle loosening of censorship, not all governments matched his humanitarian spirit during the Age of Enlightenment. Inquisitions in Rome, Portugal, and Spain continued to operate with varying degrees of zeal. Auto da fe, in which heretics were publicly executed, banished, or forced to recant, had been important ceremonial occasions in Iberia and its empire. During the first half of the 18th century, Portuguese monarchs increased their attendance at these grisly public events. Such elaborate rituals and exemplary punishments were intended to display the restoration of harmony to Catholic society. Audiences watched these awesome spectacles of divine retribution as if God's judgment were unfolding before their very eyes. The Church's elites, in conjunction with the Crown, restored order and unanimity to the community by removing and punishing those wayward individuals who, inspired by Satan, had challenged the truth and sown dissent amongst the God-fearing. The Inquisitor, in the exercise of his duties, was a high-ranking dignitary, as his authority to impose orthodoxy was delegated from the Pope. However, throughout the early modern period, the Iberian monarchies tightly directed and supervised these church courts. Papal authority over these tribunals was relatively light and symbolic, except for the Holy Office in Rome. It is assumed among scholars that during the 18th century the Inquisition was in terminal decline. While on the whole this may be true, at a regional level the picture is far more complex. In Spain, the number of inquisitors, aided by their lay familiars, staff, decreased substantially. But in Portugal, the numbers of personnel shot up between the 1750s and the 1770s. Although this increase still awaits an Anglophone study, it could be speculated that it might have to do with the fact that Paulo Antonio de Carvalho e Mendonça, the Grand Inquisitor, was the brother of the Portuguese Prime Minister Pombal. This powerful prelate, who posthumously became a cardinal, used his inquisitorial office to keep in check his brother's enemies and critics. The turning point came with the great Lisbon earthquake of the 1st of November 1755. Violent tremors began at 9:40 a.m. and flattened nearly 80% of buildings in the city in minutes. Although many survived this initial catastrophe, wildfires spread throughout the city, killing many who were trapped beneath the rubble and asphyxiating many more with its fumes. Panic spread, as much of the population fled towards the docks and open areas of the city centre, unaware that the epicentre of the earthquake had occurred off the coast. Three successive tsunami waves smashed into the beleaguered city, crushing and drowning those unfortunate enough to have headed for the port. It is calculated that as much as a quarter of the city's population of 200,000 perished in this apocalypse. The randomness and horror of this natural disaster horrified educated Europeans. It seemed impossible to believe that a major European capital could be flattened in a matter of minutes. It inspired Voltaire to write his caustic and biting novella Candide. In one famous scene, the hero of the story found himself in Lisbon after the earthquake. In a vicious satirical scene, the Inquisition was determined to find scapegoats to blame for the disaster. They seized a Basque man who had married his godmother and two Jews who refused to eat bacon. Candide and his tutor, Dr. Pangloss, were also arrested, in the words of the author, the one for speaking and the other for listening with an air of approval. Then this diverse group of unfortunate victims, excluding Candide, were executed in an auto-da-fé to placate the angry god who caused the ground to shake. A fresh earthquake immediately followed the execution of these unfortunates, thus proving either that God had been unimpressed with the human sacrifice offered to him, or that natural disasters had little to do with the supernatural. Voltaire's Lisbon sketch, brilliant as it was, exaggerated and was highly unfair in describing the church's reaction. There is little evidence that the Portuguese Inquisition indiscriminately rounded up scapegoats in the aftermath of the earthquake to placate a vengeful god. In some ways, the opposite occurred, as the earthquake gave the secular authorities an opportunity to clip the wings of the clergy. The Milanese Jesuit Gabriella Malagrida had been a missionary in Brazil. Here, his reputation for saintliness and preaching had brought him to the attention of the royal court. He was summoned to Lisbon, where his fame and reputation grew. Very unwisely, after the earthquake, he began to preach that this disaster had occurred due to the sinfulness of the Portuguese government and the dubious morals of its chief minister, Pombal. This denunciation from the pulpit displeased and offended the secular authorities. They soon saw a remarkable opportunity to use this Italian Jesuit's loose tongue to settle old scores and tighten the government's grip on power. Malagrida had formed a close friendship with the Tavora family. 3 years after the earthquake, King Joseph I was returning home after spending the evening at the Tavora palace. Suddenly, some masked men approached the carriage in the dead of night and fired 3 shots. The king escaped this attempted assassination, but he had been injured in the arm and was badly shaken. Pombal persuaded him to use this event to launch a counterstrike against the restive clergy and nobility of the realm. Under torture, 2 of the assassins claimed that the Marquess of Tavora had organized the failed regicide. Malagrida's friendship with this nobleman was enough to persuade the Inquisition to arrest him and interrogate him on suspicion of colluding in the failed assassination. A lengthy period of imprisonment broke Malagrida down, as he reported experiencing a series of visions and disturbing nightmares. The inquisitors used these as proof that their victim held non-canonical views about religion and theology. After a dubious trial, Malagrida was found guilty of heresy. On the 21st of September 1761, he was garrotted and then burned in the Rossio Square of Lisbon. This affair had little to do with real heresy, but had provided a pretext for Pombal's government to settle old scores against its enemies. Malagrida had the uncanny ability to say the wrong thing at the wrong time in the wrong place, and was too tempting a victim to release. His association with the Tavora family and the Jesuit order made him a perfect scapegoat through which the supremacy of the crown over the nobility and clergy could be reasserted. For the rest of his time in power, Pombal and his grand inquisitor brother reined in the Inquisition. After 1770, it was no longer permitted to investigate the limpeza de sangue in Portugal. This dubious legal process had allowed the Inquisition to seek out individuals with Jewish or other non-Christian ancestry. If a person was found to have Jewish blood, they were considered suspect and lost what few legal safeguards they possessed. Their property could be confiscated, and they could be arrested and detained indefinitely. It had been a barbaric instrument of early modern anti-Semitism, whose abolition was long overdue. In the Iberian Peninsula, the Inquisition was declining as an independent institution, and would stagger onwards into the 19th century. Elsewhere, during the Age of Enlightenment, monarchs gradually dispensed with this ecclesiastical court altogether. Between 1720 and 1780, many princes throughout the Italian peninsula refused to allow the Inquisition to try their subjects and disbanded the court within their domains. The decrees abolishing the Inquisition had little to do with the barbarity of its punishments, let alone enlightened values. The texts which abolished the institution in Italy focused instead on the issue of jurisdiction. For 18th century rulers, it was wrong for ecclesiastical laws to be applied independently of the state's secular laws. In the end, it was a question of ultimate authority rather than humanitarianism that sealed the Inquisition's fate. In Spain and Portugal, despite a brief interruption during Napoleon's invasions, the Inquisition would continue to operate throughout the 1820s, only to be finally abolished in 1834 by a liberal government. Within the Papal States, the Holy Office, a local name for the Inquisition, continued to exercise its jurisdiction until 1870, when the fall of Rome to the armies of the Kingdom of Italy put an end to its powers. Although these states reasserted their monopoly power over justice, the imposition of Catholicism's monopoly over public worship was still enforced by them. Failure to keep holy the Sabbath or other minor religious infractions could lead to fines and other punishments. With divorce forbidden in Catholic Europe, the only means of exiting an unhappy union was annulment or separation. This process was exceedingly rare, slow, and expensive, and one could expect massive delays as these cases often needed to be referred to Rome for final adjudication. In most cases, a legal separation of property and persons was the best that unhappy spouses could hope to achieve. Women were at a distinct disadvantage when it came to retaining custody of children in disputes with their husbands. The only upside was that before the French Revolution, female plaintiffs in many European jurisdictions retained some control over their dowry through complex marriage contracts. Another important administrative function that the church undertook was the maintenance of the civil registers. The secular state delegated the task of recording births, marriages, and deaths to parish priests. An individual's entire civil existence was contingent on being Catholic. Protestants and Jews living in Western and Southern Europe had little hope of official recognition in these parish registers. Their baptisms, bar or bat mitzvahs, and marriages were considered null and void. It was only with the emergence of edicts of toleration during the 1780s in the Habsburg realms and France that non-Catholics started gaining some measure of recognition from the state. Throughout the 18th century, ecclesiastical authorities continued to contribute actively to the administration of the state. However, this participation came to be questioned by ministers, bureaucrats, and jurists, who wondered whether the clergy possessed the competence and reforming values necessary to carry this administrative burden. As state power increased and laws slowly came to be reformed, they freed themselves from the strictures of canon law and ecclesiastical courts. The other great foundation of ecclesiastical power was landholding. In Catholic Europe, The church could own anywhere from 10 to 20% of agricultural land. Given that most European economies of the time were agrarian, it meant that about a fifth of the European economy was tax-exempt and beyond state control. In cities, this percentage was often higher, given that cathedral closes, prebends, and confraternities controlled massive real estate portfolios, including houses, buildings, and commercial properties. If you were a city tenant in the early modern world, it was likely that your landlord would be Holy Mother Church. Throughout Europe, bishops and archbishops controlled wealth that was the equivalent to the GDP of small principalities. The archbishops of Paris, Reims, and Strasbourg commanded revenues that ran to hundreds of thousands of French livres. This was by no means unique. The Archbishop of Toledo had an annual income of millions of reals, and the Bishop of Krakow earned 1 million zlotys a year from his properties. But there were significant geographical and regional variations in the first estate's landholding patterns. In France and Spain, about 15% of all arable lands was held by the church. But as this was prime real estate, its economic value was probably much higher than these estimates suggest. These two realms each had a population of 200,000 clergymen. While this may not seem surprising, it should be borne in mind that throughout the 18th century the population of Spain was half that of France, so the per capita concentration of priests in Iberia was remarkably high. The situation reached its apogee in Italy. In Bologna, at the heart of the papal legations, up to 10% of the city's population had taken religious vows. You literally could not swing a cat without hitting a priest in this town. Although the Holy Roman Empire had seen the secularization of much ecclesiastical property during the Reformation, the Church of Rome still held about 12% of all German land. This allowed the Reichskirche, or Imperial Church, to control the selection of about 10% of deputies sent to the Imperial Diet. Even in Poland, at the very margins of the Catholic world, the Church owned roughly 14% of all land. The Polish Church was atypical, possessing around 8,000 parish priests, outnumbered by over 17,000 monks and nuns, who dominated the clerical landscape on the banks of the Vistula. The Szlachta, Polish nobility, paid more in tithes to the church than they did in taxation to the state. Fiscal immunity, the power to levy taxes and massive property investments, made the church an extremely attractive career for ambitious men. Second sons of the nobility, or those unsuited for the military life, were often selected to take holy orders and eventually secure a bishopric. Until the mid-17th century, a handful of families in the Holy Roman Empire monopolized all the top ecclesiastical jobs. By the 1750s, the Wittelsbachs, Habsburgs, and other Catholic royal families were experiencing a shortage of sons. This meant that the scions of free imperial knights and other lesser nobles could grab lucrative ecclesiastical preferment for themselves. It was hardly a democratization of the church, given that proof of nobility in Germany was incredibly rigorous. Even Catholic canons had to prove that all their great-grandparents had been noble before taking their seats in the chapter. But many commoners, too, sought ecclesiastical preferment. Bright young men used the good education provided by the church to launch brilliant political and intellectual careers. A lack of vocation was no impediment, nor was chastity rigorously enforced. The brother of the last king of Poland, Michał Dziertzi Poniatowski, Archbishop of Gniezno and Primate of all Poland, sired some remarkably successful illegitimate offspring, despite his vow of sexual abstinence. Hierarchies within the regional churches were often murky, and conflicts of authority common. For example, the Prince Archbishop of Salzburg, patron of the Mozart family, was not only a sovereign in his own right, he also held the title of Primas Germaniae, Primate of Germany. This caused much resentment, given that the Archbishop Electors of Mainz and of Trier claimed this title too. The incumbent of Mainz also held the honorific position of Arch-Chancellor of Germany, which which he claimed made him de facto head of the German church. Given the autonomy, privileges, and complexity of the ecclesiastical principalities on the Rhine, it is not surprising that a distinct tradition of independence from Rome emerged. Although the Council of Trent had banned pluralism, that is, the holding of more than one diocese by the same man, its practice was common throughout these territories. Across the Rhine, in France, the situation was equally fraught. The Archbishop of Lyon flaunted the grandiloquent title of Primate of All Gaul. His claims to leadership of the Gallican Church were contested by his colleague in Rhin, who styled himself Primate of Belgian Gaul, and the Archbishop of Rouen, who held the title of Primate of Normandy. In 1696, the Archbishop of Rouen sued his counterpart in Lyon to assert his independence. After years of wrangling, he won his court case in 1703. Despite this, French archbishops failed to establish a clear chain of command during the 18th century, and the papacy dared not interfere. Only the challenge of revolution managed to establish an unprecedented unity of purpose and coordination among French bishops. But by 1790, it was too late. Only the Pope's title of Primate of Italy seems to have been uncontroversial and accepted by all. Another major source of power, prestige, and wealth was the abbeys scattered across Catholic Europe. Noblemen and women were keen to become abbots and abbesses of these institutions. Through a system known as holding an abbey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.